Grand Theft Auto is one of those very few series where I try my best to grab the new game day one. I grabbed the slightly fancy special edition for GTA 5 on release, after staying up all night trying to finally 100% San Andreas by getting all the collectibles. I bought the fancy lockbox version of GTA 4 on release day, and then miraculously came down with a cold, yes, really, which allowed me to stay home for a few days playing it whenever I didn't feel like death. I got San Andreas along with the strategy guide only like a couple of months after release. It was the first game I chose to grab for my new used PS2, while my younger brother got Ratchet and Clank Up Your Arsenal. And a few days before that, along with our PS2s themselves, we were given a copy of Vice City, which I promptly played for only those few days before San Andreas sucked me in for years. I had played Vice City at friends' houses several times up to that point, but San Andreas' much larger world kept calling me back. Some months later, I spent my birthday money on copies of Final Fantasy X, Kingdom Hearts 1, and GTA 3 to complete the PS2 trilogy. I expected that game to be smaller and more rudimentary than San Andreas. I wasn't foolish. What I didn't expect was a game that was so comparatively clunky and difficult that I'd straight up never finish it. Even as late as 2012 or so, when I restarted a new file on both GTA 3 and Vice City and tried to push through them, I ended up getting stuck on both games. In GTA 3, I think I got stuck between the missions Grand Theft Auto, Payday for Ray, and Plaster Blaster, or something like that. The lower frame rate, awful composite cable I had to use, rough and clunky controls, and the brutal mission demands all asked too much from me, and I eventually just got tired of trying. So up until now, I'd never beaten GTA 3 or Vice City, despite owning them both for nearly 20 years. Now though, I have access to the definitive the Definitive Edition mods. While the official Definitive Edition includes several quality of life improvements above the Definitive Edition mod and the original game, which we'll get into, I chose to try and play a version that is more like a faithful remaster, but with tweaks to make it more playable. The main differences here come down to a lack of loading screens between islands, which might have just been part of the vanilla PC version's updated models that I believe are taken from the mobile ports, meaning they're single meshes instead of a bunch of separate polygonal chunks animated in unison, and right-stick camera control both in vehicles and on the ground. In the original PS2 version, moving the right stick would put you in a first-person view, and the second you move the left stick, it would revert back to third-person. And the only way to look around in your car was using the L2 and R2 snapping, with no way to angle it up for hills and the like. I can thankfully play the game in 4K at 60fps here, and while there are stutters from time to time, they're clearly related to the age of this port rather than because the game is particularly heavy. The one downside compared to the PS2 version is that there are no pressure-sensitive face buttons, so if you want analog control over your gas and brakes in cars, you'll need to map them to your triggers instead. But that feels unnatural to me, having played these games with the original control scheme for so long. And while it would have made a bit of a difference here and there, simply tapping them rhythmically has a similar effect. Though, to be fair, that's going to be an issue in basically every re-release of the game except for the PS3 version and the official Definitive Edition, without a control remap that will also change your on-foot controls. So, with this version of the game aiming to be as faithful as possible while being more playable, how does GTA 3 hold up 22 years after its release? If you only play the first few hours, you might think it holds up shockingly well. At that point, the game is pretty simple and pretty easy. Low stakes and low threat means that when the game gets in your way, it's not too bothersome. But once the kid gloves come off, for me, GTA 3 turned into a nightmare. Missions were all over the place in terms of challenge, and every time it got more brutal, the shortcomings of the title shone through crystal clear. I cannot stress enough just how back and forth the difficulty becomes in this game. Part of it might be because of how I, and I'd suspect most people, generally play through these early GTA games. These games tended to give you a mission strand from a mission giver, and then a few missions in, another mission giver would show up, and sometimes a third one would show up as well after a few missions from the second mission giver. Once someone is done giving you missions, they more or less disappear from the narrative much of the time. As such, I think most people generally just stick to one mission giver at a time, until they either get stuck, or they finish it and can move on to someone else, when they usually have their own little compact narratives. Since they don't always impact the larger narrative, it's easier to understand what's happening with them if you just plow through all their missions at once. Generally, that means you'll get harder and harder missions from them, and then you'll get a break with some easier missions when you move on to the next person. Normally, that's a good flow, but in this case, I think that GTA 3's later missions for each mission giver get so difficult that it instead makes the game feel uneven. The start of each mission strand isn't a moment to relax, it's a frustrating slap in the face after you just spent an hour retrying the previous mission for someone else. And then, for example, if this strand is only 3 missions instead of 5 or 6, that respite lasts for only a few minutes, before the second mission ratchets up to an 8 out of 10 again, and then the last one is an 11 out of 10. GTA 3 is far from the most difficult game I've ever played, but there are many factors intentionally built into the design that simply pull no punches. The mission timers can often be really strict, requiring the perfect route and excellent driving from you. Sometimes they're not even really completable unless you bring a higher-end sports car that has tons of speed, but the game of course won't tell you this, nor provide the car for you a lot of the time. The game also refuses to give you information you need to complete a mission as well. I don't know what a Yardie or a Colombian gang member looks like, let alone what vehicles they drive. Half the time it's obvious, like an optional phone mission telling you to shoot the guys wearing purple, but not the ones wearing red, and it gives you their names along with those colors. Other times their vehicles are obvious because they're clearly modified, like the Diablo Stallion, which has flames and a blower coming out of the hood. Which, by the way, there's a mission that asks you to grab one of these, but calls it a Diablo Infernus instead, which was removed from the game before release as far as I understand it. So if you know what a normal Infernus looks like, you might be looking for the Diablo variant for ages, unless you're smart enough to try the Stallion instead. But other gangs are very nondescript, and the game won't do anything to cement them in your mind beforehand, and the same can be said for their vehicles at points. You might think this is an issue where you should be looking in the physical manual for information, similar to the physical map early versions of the game came with. Nope. This is all that the manual gives you about the gangs, so you know the name of the vehicle, and using this in conjunction with the physical map, you can figure out their territory. But the physical map is such a cluttered mess that for me it was more frustrating than engaging to break this stuff out of my PS2 copy again. And without stopping every 5 minutes to look at it, I'll have no idea what a Fort Staunton is or whatever. Somewhat simple solution though, right? Just use the in-game map. Oh, what? There is no in-game map, meaning you only get the mini-map to go off of? And what's that? Icons for everything other than missions disappear after they've been first introduced? And the only non-mission icons that show back up are safe house icons when you get close enough to them, meaning you have to use an outside source and memorization to know where things like pain sprays and ammunitions are? You need a physical hospital to heal because saving doesn't heal you? You need to remember where that random late game shop is that sells the rocket launcher? Well, you'd better hope you don't get food poisoning halfway through playing like I did, meaning you don't play the game for a week, otherwise you're memorizing all of this twice at least. The minimap doesn't even do a great job of differentiating between overlapping roads all the time. Sometimes it's clear because the higher altitude road will cut through the lower road, and other times they're just a map of overlapping spaghetti that's barely discernible as multiple roads at all. And all of this means that when you're given nothing more than an objective marker off in the distance that might be on one of the other islands, you end up wasting tons of time failing missions purely because you had no effective way to navigate to that goal without tedious trial and error. Your physical map isn't gonna update with objective markers. This problem is exacerbated thanks to the width of the islands and the very limited exits from one island to another. These exits are also usually kind of convoluted to get to, meaning they're a gamble to commit to. But you usually need to commit to searching the current island or heading back toward the one closest road that leads to another island, which will leave you backtracking or risking flipping your car on a makeshift shortcut if you pick wrong. It sounds like a small thing, but it ends up much more frustrating than you'd think if you don't have the entire game memorized. Remember, no map? weak minimap, and really tight timers. These are the types of things that, as far as I understand it, are indeed improved in the official Definitive Edition. I don't know if there are mods for the PC version that I could have added to this DE mod in order to solve that problem. But again, it's important to know that if you play any other version of this game that's more directly based on the PS2 original, this is what you'll have to deal with. A lot of the other issues here are growing pains for Rockstar. They're clearly not intended parts of the difficulty so much as oversights that make the game more frustrating than necessary. To throw out a few examples, car suspension is far too bouncy at times, especially on cars like the Cheetah or basically any SUV or truck style vehicle. Hoods also never seem to fly off without extra impacts, meaning they get in the way when they're knocked open. Missions using boats can also be janky because you can't swim, but there's no way to smoothly exit boats back onto shore. It's always tense for the wrong reasons when you're trying to make it back to land, especially on a time limit or under the threat of a high wanted level. Civilians have a tendency to immediately carjack you back if you carjack them from the passenger's side, which guarantees that Claude will lay on the ground for like 4 or 5 seconds and then get punched as soon as he stands up. That lost time or that lost health might have just lost you the mission. The lock-on system isn't that great either. It's too short range regardless of what weapon you're using, and it's rather finicky if you're not facing the enemy directly. Enemies can also melt you almost instantly, even with full health and armor. That also means running around to fill your armor and health after every mission is yet more tedium you have to contend with, on top of PS2 era GTA's lack of autosaves and checkpoints that necessitate saving after every mission, just in case the next one kills you and leaves you without the hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of weapons and ammo you might have been building up. Car health is equivalent to the strength of wet tissue paper, and that pairs terribly with the fact that traffic switches lanes at ridiculous speeds. They'll even make illegal maneuvers like crossing double yellow lines to pass people. All of this combined with the strict timers, speed of AI cars that you need to keep up with and destroy, or speed of AI opponents in races, means that it's very easy to end up with your car on fire within just a couple of hard crashes. Doubly so if you're going through hostile gang territory, where the gang members all clearly have aimbots that register you're rolling past them within just a few frames. Traffic also has a tendency to obsessively switch to the left lane on bridges. Once you know that, it's actually okay as long as you don't get stuck in an awkward spot at the wrong time, but until you do, it gives the impression that there's something in their AI that convinces them to try and get in your way intentionally. You might think it's realistic for the traffic in this game to do dangerous, illegal stuff at times. I humored that idea too while I was ruminating on my frustrations, but that's kind of a moot point, because it's not realistic for them to be able to move out of their lane and in front of your car in a quarter of a second. There are plenty of times where they're just straight up unreactable, and so when they're not even following traffic rules, you're never really safe from an accident wrecking your attempt at a brutal, long mission. To be clear, most of the earlier missions are generally fine. Some have annoying quirks, but they rarely get too difficult, at least in the case of the mandatory ones. Bomb to Base, Act 2, can be a little frustrating, if only because your ally 8-Ball has no sense of self-preservation once you start shooting at your enemies. The aptly titled mission Grand Theft Auto is also notorious for its tight timings. You have to head to 3 sports cars across the game world and bring them to a garage in a time limit. They all also have to be pristine when they arrive. The time isn't the tightest, but it's not lenient. And if you're smart, you'll realize there's a pay and spray right outside the goal, so you can be pretty reckless on the way there. If I wasn't playing at 60 FPS and adept at driving and racing games, I think I'd have a much harder time here though, doubly so with the original PS2 in-car camera control. The mission Plaster Blaster has you ramming an ambulance until someone in a body cast falls out. You then have to run him over until you deplete a health bar, all while swarmed by police. Not only does the game just sometimes not register you running him over particularly well, but the police are relentless and you're forced to continually hover around the same spot while they surround you. In fact, while there are missions that are difficult for other reasons, often because of timers, it really is the unpredictable stuff like police or traffic that can be the most frustrating. In the mission Sam, for example, once you down the plane and get stars, it's kind of luck whether the helicopter that shows up starts shooting earlier or later, as well as how accurate it ends up being. You can't really avoid its fire effectively, your boat doesn't have a ton of health, you'll potentially have to fight rough waters on your way back to land, and then you're a sitting duck while trying to haphazardly and sloppily get back on land without falling in the ocean and immediately failing. From there, you then have to find a car and escape the police without being vaporized by their gunfire. Issues with gunfire utterly destroying you while you frantically try to get the lock-on to function properly, or try to edge just enough outside of cover to be able to target enemies around the collision while keeping yourself safe, are pretty regular occurrences the deeper into the game you get. The mission Grand Theft Aero is a solid example of this, with several enemies intentionally placed in areas that you can't easily lock onto or aim at, and a big, vulnerable target in the middle that fails the mission if it's destroyed. So explosives are a huge risk here, where they'd normally be a solid but expensive solution. The mission directly after that, Escort Service, is another one where the AI is what leads to frustration. You have to slowly and painfully follow an armored vehicle through some tight tunnels to the third island. This takes ages, and nothing really happens until you exit the tunnel, meaning each failure is tedious as heck. But it's not really up to you how the armored car deals with traffic, meaning it can take chip damage on the way through and slow the mission down even more. Then once you reach the third island, it's bombarded by gunfire and such that you likely won't be able to stop on your first try because you won't know exactly where it's coming from. Thankfully, one trick I tried that worked okay was staying behind a bit. If you do that, far less traffic seems to show up in front of the armored vehicle, speeding things up and leading to less unnecessary, uncontrollable damage along the way. Sometimes the unpredictability is okay. I, for example, didn't mind the mission Decoy where you get 6 stars and need to run from the police for a certain amount of time. It can be exhilarating to think on your feet like that, but importantly in a mission like this, I'm in control of where I go and what I do. As such, I can really stretch my legs and choose strategies that are best for me. While that's largely more true in this game than later GTA titles on the face of it, when you actually get down to the nitty-gritty, you realize that there usually is a huge chasm between the effectiveness of certain strategies over others. Just because you can choose between the two doesn't mean they're equal. Espresso to Go is another mission that is notoriously difficult if you aren't the most adept at driving. You have to hit the espresso stands pretty hard sometimes to destroy them, and getting stars can almost guarantee failure thanks to the timer being so restrictive. Even just switching cars more than once can take up too much time, doubly so if you get unlucky with frequency of spawns, proximity of spawns, or the type of cars that spawn. The final mission, The Exchange, can be optimized in a few ways, and while it's an interesting idea in theory, it's super frustrating that you lose all of your weapons at the start and have to use what you find from there. It's just a sea of enemies with extremely powerful machine guns, many of which are intentionally hidden just out of view until it's too late. And then the game will surprise you with ridiculous gacha obstacles, like a truck that suddenly tries to run you over, immediately followed by a carpet bombing from above that will both hit you and can blow the truck up too close to you, which will kill you. There are explosive barrels, but targeting them while the truck is close enough without getting run over just isn't in the cards for most people with these controls, at least on gamepad. Side missions have similar problems. Turismo is infamous for being available so early, but having such fast cars as race opponents. Trial by Fire, where you're supposed to burn 25 triads, can be luck-based. Bling Bling Scramble can also feel like luck. You're tasked with hitting more checkpoints than your opponents. When someone gets one, it disappears and the next one appears. But importantly, their appearances are disparate rather than linear. As such, even if your opponent falls behind, they can end up nearby the next checkpoint anyway. Uzi Money has you shooting purple shirt guys while inevitably also angering the red shirt guys you're not supposed to kill. But the timing is once again tight. They ravage your car, meaning you'll probably have to switch at least once, and therefore the spawns of both replacement vehicles and the right gang members can get in the way of success. And like, I enjoy a lot of the concepts here. Toyminator has you blow up 3 targets by driving RC Bandit vehicles, but if you hit any car, the RC car explodes. Bullion Run has a mess of objectives you need to pick up and then drive to a nearby drop-off, but every few pickups will alert the police, and the more pickups you currently have in your vehicle, the slower it drives. I even like the concepts of Uzi Money and Bling Bling Scramble, if they weren't so random. Same with main missions like the final one, Espresso to Go, Sam, or Plaster Blaster. While the majority of missions here are pretty standard and uncreative by modern sensibilities, there are ones here that are inspired. It's just unfortunate that those ones are also generally the ones that feel like they needed the most work. More scripting and guardrails are okay when a mission instead turns into a mess without them. Beyond the core gameplay and missions, I don't have a ton to say. The story is basically a big pile of nothing. Half the time, new mission strands for people you don't know just show up, and the game acts like you've already met. No calls to tell you to stop by or anything. And then 2 missions later, you're betraying your other allies, no questions asked. Claude has no agency, but neither does the player. But it also feels like you're the most powerful person in the room at nearly all times, so it can't be excused away as Claude needing to submit in order to stay alive or something. The ending movie is also very weird because of the chosen music. Not bad music, but it feels ill-fitting. Also, Claude killing Maria is not a particularly funny joke, but also is a horrible payoff considering all we went through to repeatedly save her. I just fail to see the point, and I think it speaks to a level of unintentional immaturity and lack of polish in Rockstar's writing that would be rectified in future games. The radio stations are also fairly limited here. They're okay, but it's clear this was still kind of a ragtag group without the budget for the biggest hits. It's definitely the weakest soundtrack of the PS2 era GTA titles. In the end, I think I could enjoy this game if it had San Andreas' quality of life improvements, but even with some of the improvements using these mods, the game just feels wildly messy. One second, it's shockingly easy. The next, there's a bottleneck in a mission that turns into a nightmare. The normal Definitive Edition is probably a better option than this mod or any other version of GTA, if only because of the improved controls, the map, and other quality of life updates. It's unfortunate that this means you are forced into the updated visuals to get these improvements, because whether they're good or bad, sometimes you just want something more faithful. Though you might be able to mod the PC version further in order to get closer to that quality of life offered in the official Definitive Edition. I'm glad I finally beat GTA 3, but personally, I don't think it's worth beating. It was rarely that fun, and I think the freedom its defenders champion is way overblown. You have freedom, but it comes at a severe cost in polish, creativity of mission design, and requires dealing with extremely archaic game design limitations. Driver 2 is a better game, don't at me.